My presentation will not deal with an object of art, but with a family-related ex-voto in the context of contemporary pilgrimages to St. Mary in Lourdes. It will shed light on the politics of the Marian Shrine, as the French site in Lourdes is a politicized space where those in power contest the religious materials and determine which ex-voto can be included and which need to be excluded from the place. I will also focus on the poetics of the narrative behind one particular ex-voto. In doing so, I give consideration not so much on the aesthetic aspects of the object, but rather to the story and the people behind the object. The central object is an ex-voto dedicated to the Lady of Lourdes by a French family called Croton. This family went to Lourdes in order to realize their mother's lifelong wish to get her story heard and to thank Mary in public for her miraculous healing. It's a pilgrimage in which I did not participate. I even don't know the pilgrims personally. I never saw them or spoke to them, but I intimately met them in the ex-voto they offered to the Lady of Lourdes. The story behind this object will show that ex-voto are not only objects of thanksgiving, but of remembering as well. This picture shows the ex-voto like it was handed over to the Lourdes Sanctuary in 2000. No. This one. And here we see the ex-voto with all the documentation added to it by both the Croton family and the archivist in Lourdes. The discovery of this particular ex-voto was part of my research on Marian pilgrimage and the power dimensions at stake in the Lourdes Shrine. The interesting problem with many ex-votos offered by individual devotees to their beloved St. Mary is that they are so ordinary, so mundane, having no material or aesthetic value at all, and that they are, for all these reasons, so contested. Scholar of material culture Colleen McDaniel states that as early as the 6th century, synods and councils placed restrictions on ex-votos because of lingering pagan associations. Even today, at the world-famous pilgrimage site in Lourdes, ex-votos are highly contested. The authorities of the shrine want to remove them from the sacred space. They associate the ex-votos with magic, with excessive Marian devotion, with irrationality, with everyday and private life, and often don't consider them to be religious at all. The official religion, as prescribed by the authorities of the shrine, clashes with the lived religion and the needs of the pilgrims, for whom the ex-voto are precious, intimate gifts for their beloved St. Mary. The shrine's authorities strive, among other things, for synchrony and homogeneity of all movements and all objects at the site. And therefore, they remove the personal expressions of Marian devotion that challenge these central values. So here we see the sanctuary and its boundaries. And within the boundaries of the shrine, there is no particular place where pilgrims can leave their personal offerings behind. Officially, these ex-votos even don't exist. The pilgrims, however, deliberately aim at connecting their personal devotion, their family history, and their private suffering to this world-famous sacred space. Now, there is a great variety of ex-votos, as we have also seen in the exhibition. These pictures show the less artistic, exhibition-worthy objects, the mess the shrine in Lourdes refuses to accommodate. Ex-voto, indeed, are often objects of little monetary value. They can be handiwork, have people knit, embroider, crochet, cut and paste, to thank Mary for her kindness. But also personal belongings, like used clothes, baby clothes, wedding dresses, private photographs, or locks of hair can be offered to thank the lady for her graces. Now, perhaps the most familiar ones are these ex-voto that represent particular parts of the body that were healed through divine intervention. And I think that in this tradition, we can place the ex-voto of Madame Croton, which represents her injured knee that was healed through a prayer to the Lady of Lourdes. In line with pilgrimage scholar John Eat, I will demonstrate that Lourdes, as a tightly controlled and orchestrated shrine, does not offer much space for individual creativity, but that pilgrims may go through the official boundaries of the sacred space to get their story heard and their bond with Mary recognized. These pictures show how pilgrims add their personal things to the sacred space. Here we see the photographs of deceased children and flags that are fastened on the candles. And here we see that pilgrims left behind some children's toys in between Bernadette's sheep with the names of the children written on them. And these personal things will be tolerated only for some hours before the helpers of the shrine's officials remove them from the space to make it clean again. In the grotto, pilgrims have to go around quickly in a constant stream of people. The efficient organization of the ritual does not leave much time for private devotion. Pilgrims, however, do try to leave their photographs and flowers behind in the grotto. The only official place to leave their personal letters is the closed mailbox you see on the left. Pilgrims, however, prefer to leave their personal notes much closer to the powerful statue of Mary by inserting them directly into the grotto. Formerly, the pilgrims could express their personal devotion in the Cahier des Intentions. In these prayer books, pilgrims wrote down their personal wishes and they could leave small notes and photographs behind, as we see in this picture. In 2000, however, the sanctuary removed these prayer books from the basilicas and created the possibility to send prayers on the internet. So here again, the shrine gives in to efficiency and not to the religious wishes of the pilgrims. So why does the shrine oppose to all these personal proofs of Mary's miracles? Does it have to do with efficiency and the smoothly organized receptions of millions of pilgrims? Yes, it does. But there is more. And that is the shrine's reluctance to publicly display marks of miraculous healings. In the 19th century, belief in miraculous healing was actively promoted by the shrine in order to refute secular rationalism. Today, official emphasis has switched from a miracle discourse to a sacrificial discourse. So rather than acknowledging the miracles, the sacrificial discourse emphasizes the spiritual merits of physical suffering. So because of this change in orientation, that took place around the turn of the century, the shrine's officials removed all the sticks that pilgrims had left behind in the grotto. From the shrine's establishment in 1858, pilgrims used to leave their sticks behind and display them as ex voto as proofs of their healing. The officials removed these sticks and today publicly declare that even the water of Lourdes has no healing elements, that research has proved the water to be just normal water, having no therapeutic qualities. So they are so reluctant to recognize people's healings in Lourdes that since Bernadette's visions of Mary in 1858, only 70 healings have been accepted by the shrine. Now, corresponding with the official standpoint that the shrine doesn't want to awaken or to display miracles, no single factory-made ex voto is found in the numerous souvenir shops that can be found in Lourdes. The shopping area is huge, and all kinds of souvenirs are at sale, but ex votos, like the metal plates with the healed body parts on it, cannot be found. And when I asked the shop owners why I couldn't find these items, they answered that they had been ordered by the shrine not to sell them. Now, the trouble I personally had when I tried to study ex voto at the Lourdes Shrine during my fieldwork also illustrates the sharp division between the dominant discourse of the shrine's authorities and the religious practices of the pilgrims. So I will tell a little bit about my own fieldwork. At the shrine, I started at an office that is called ex voto. So I thought, oh, that's the place to be. In 2 weeks' time, I entered this office almost every day to ask information about the ex voto. Though the nuns who worked at the desk, they received me friendly, they were, however, not willing to help me with my quest for people's personal ex voto. They repeatedly showed me a form that I had to fill in order to get the only officially recognized ex voto. Now, these accepted ex voto are marble plaques for which you can choose the size and the number of words that will be engraved. And the larger the dimension and the larger the number of words you want to have engraved, the more you pay. Now, in that year, there were about 100 applications with words expressing thanks. Thanks for the birth of a child, the recovery of a child or a grandchild, request for protecting a child or protecting a family, or less defined expressions like merci pour une grâce, merci à Marie, merci à Notre-Dame de Lourdes, or simply remerciement. At the ex-voto desk, again and again, the sisters sent me to the basilicas and the crypt to see all those uniform and impersonal ex-voting. And they also explained to me that the Lourdes shrine does not accept the homemade ex-voto to prevent chaos and disorder. At this place, they said, where 6 million of pilgrims pass by each year, we cannot accept that pilgrims leave behind all kind of personal possessions. Imagine that situation, how messy the place should be, with all those personal gifts. No, you have to understand that we cannot tolerate this practice. And then they laughed away the idea of the statue of Mary in the grotto, decorated with all kinds of jewelry. And once again, they showed me the form to fill in to get my marble plaque, and they sent me to the basilicas to examine the most recent ones. Now, I came to understand that the Lourdes shrine didn't accept the personal ex-votos, but I wondered how the pilgrims could know that they didn't have to bring their ex-voto with them. So I went back to the nuns at the ex-voto desk to discuss my reflections on the pilgrims coming from countries like Italy, Spain, and Portugal, but also Latin America and Asia. Pilgrims who are used to take along their personal ex-votos to holy places. What happened with all these ex-votos when they arrived in Lourdes and did not find a place to offer them? The sisters were very amused to see me again. But now they no longer gave me the form to obtain my marble plaque in the basilica, but they told me, oh yes, there was just an Italian couple passed by and they left a wedding dress behind. Look over there, it's still there. So now go to the archives and ask for the archivist. She will be very happy to see you. Now, next to the upper entrance of the Lourdes Shrine, there is a big building that accommodates the shrine's archives. And the curator has to secure all valuable donations the shrine receives from the organizers of the different pilgrimages to Lourdes. And these donations mainly consist of golden chalices and monstrances, costly canonicals, precious altar cloth, lacework, banners, golden jewelry, etc. These donations, of course, do not come from individual pilgrims, but mostly from the local churches that organize the pilgrimage to Lourdes. And these donations can be so expensive that they are transferred to the museum called Museum of Precious Objects that is situated next to the archives. Now, the archivist indeed received me with open arms, but still I was not sure if I really found the place of the personal ex-votos I wanted to study. She showed me the museum and the precious objects and advised me to visit the museum the next day again. When I told her that I was curious to see the ex-voto individual pilgrims had offered to the Lady of Lourdes, she once again sent me to the crypt to study the marble plaques. And I left the archives with a map of the crypt and decided to come back the next day. And that day, I told her I didn't want to see the precious objects nor the marble plaques, but the worthless things pilgrims take along from home, personal possessions or handicrafts. And now she really seemed happy to see me, and she welcomed me into the world of the ex-voto. C'est enorme, she added. It's huge, and she was right. She offered me a look in her always closed private unit at the upper floor of the archives. And I discovered an immense variety of objects. I saw all kinds of paintings decorated with embroidery, knitting and beads. There were framed panels containing all kinds of personal things like white and blue clothes, handkerchiefs, human hair, completed with written prayers and private pictures. And there were also all kinds of things related to small children like bibs, clothes, socks, shoes, toys, christening dresses, and used bandages. And of course, I also discovered the sticks, the prostheses, the plasters, etc. It was really huge. She now sincerely showed me how happy she was to see me because her work, she said, is hidden work. Work that the officials don't approve. It's a man's world, she said, and I'm prepared to see them one day announcing that I have to stop this work. We go back to her office. Because these officials, they don't value it. They say it's rubbish. They are throwaway articles having no monetary or aesthetic value. But she said, I have passion. I love these ex-voto. I care for them and I give them the place that they deserve, very next to the statue of Our Lady. And as the archivist has no official place to keep these items, she decorates her own office with them. Now, in this way, she saved many personal offerings. However, because of the informal and also the hidden character of her work, most of the offerings were badly documented. She also didn't know much about the people who had left these ex photos at the shrine, because it was another helper, also a disobedient person working at the shrine, who, when he found these items, he brought them to the archivist to keep them and to save them. The archivist, however, she presented me one particular ex-voto that was well documented because she personally met the family who offered it to the shrine. This ex-voto, she said, is the memory of a family. The small object with all the documents and photographs added to it indeed tells a family history. At the very heart of this ex-voto is some old candle grease. Louise Croton called it La Petite Jambe, the small leg, or Mon Souvenir de la Vierge Marie. It is placed on a basis of white cotton wool and light blue lace, and this altogether is stored in a silver-colored rosary box with the image of Mary and Bernadette on top. This box again is placed in a bigger dark brown wooden box with a lining of red velour. On the top of it, Louise herself wrote the name of Lourdes in white ornamental letters. Now, Louise's 4 pages long letter reveals the meaning of this small piece of old candle grease. It tells that when she was pregnant, she had a nasty fall in the garden in 1933. She hurts her knee, her leg swells up, and she can hardly walk anymore. She has to stay in bed for several months and ask her parents, who at that time went on a pilgrimage to Lourdes, to pray for her and for a prosperous healing. So they agree that they will pray together at the same time, at the same day and at the same time, at 8:30 in the evening, when the candlelight procession starts in Lourdes. Louise will pray at home, next to a statue of the Lady of Lourdes, while burning a Lourdes candle. The candle in Louise's home keeps on burning until it ends in a small piece of wax, having the form of a small leg from knee till toes. It carefully displays the painful parts of Louise's body, her knee and her swollen foot. At first, Louise is frightened to see this transformation of the wax. She thinks of Mary, feels a shudder all through her body, and then discovers that she can walk in the way she did before. As she was pregnant, she immediately asked Mary for a successful birth of her child. And the next month, on the day one celebrates the Immaculate Heart of Mary, her daughter is born in good health. To thank Mary for all this, Louise wants the healing to be recognized, and she writes down her story and sends it to the Chapel of the Miraculous Medal in Rue du Bac in Paris. She addresses her letter to Paris as she thinks the Lourdes annals are kept in the French capital. However, as it was not the Miraculous Lady, but the Lady of Lourdes who healed her, she receives a letter from Paris in 1944, telling her that she has to go to Lourdes in southern France to get her healing recognized. Now, Louise, she lived in the upper north of France, never undertook this journey and died in 1990. Apart from her husband, nobody knew about this miracle. Her three children discovered the leg, the mother's letter, and the letter from Paris after her death, and they decide to realize their mother's wish after all. So in 1998, Louise's daughter, Marie-Thérèse, goes on a pilgrimage to Lourdes and searches for the medical doctor who has to examine the miraculous healing. And he is also a deviant helper because she advises them to bring Louise's treasure to Lourdes and to offer it to the archives, to the curator, because they were friends. So finally, in 2000, 67 years after miraculous healing, Louise's souvenir finds her resting place in Lourdes. Now, the photograph that testifies this important event is also added to the exphoto. It shows Louise's three children, their spouses, a cousin that had been raised by Louise, Louise's daughter who was born 1 month after the healing, and her great-grandson. Four generations in front of the basilica, carrying the deed of deposit and remembering that small souvenir their mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother received from Mary. So the deed of deposit thus received the official stamps of the shrine's archives in spite of the dominant discourse that miraculous healings no longer belong to the shrine. Till today, Louise's grandchildren come to Lourdes to visit the exphoto. Only 1 week prior to one of my own visits to the archives, Brigitte, one of Louise's granddaughters, came to the archives and asked to see the exphoto. She came with her husband and two friends to whom she wanted to show the small leg of wax. I read the form that she had to fill in when visiting the archives, and I learned that she asked for the exvoto to remember my grandmother and to remember my mother, Marie-Thérèse, who died 2 months ago. So the exvoto itself turned into a shrine. The exvoto of the Creton family is one of the few victories pilgrims gain over the shrine's officials. So my search for the exvoto illustrates what John Eade calls the continual interplay of opposing forces at pilgrimage sites. And the shrine wants to keep the contested materials outside, whereas the pilgrims want to bring their personal thank yous inside and very close to Mary. So the only chance the pilgrims can have is to meet some helpers of the shrine's officials who distance themselves from the dominant discourse and guide them towards the archives. Only then the pilgrims get around the official politics of the shrine and get the opportunity to give their exvoto the destination they aimed for. Thank you.